Welcome to Eurodollar University. We're recording this on December 9th, the day that initial jobless claims slumped to a 52-year low in the United States. According to Trading Economics, the jobless claims in the U.S. dropped by 43,000 from the previous period to 184,000 in the week ending December 4th, the lowest since early September 1969 and below market expectations of 215,000. This means that this is a level consistent with healthy labor market conditions, as demand for labor remains strong amid the ongoing economic recovery and as many employers seek to retain workers. Jeff Snider, the head of global research for Alhambra Partners, and I, Emil Kalinowski, we're going to talk about that in today's episode of Eurodollar University. Jeff, we're going to use your article at Alhambra Investments. It was titled A Global JOLTS in July as our springboard to talk about the situation in the United States, the employment situation. And the JOLTS numbers are really, really, really good. Well, at least one part of them, the job openings, maybe not a record high, but for October, they were still near ridiculous all-time highs. Great news, I think.
Yeah, and I think it goes along with what you just said with jobless claims. We have an ultra low level of those, which at least suggests that the amount of workers being involuntarily laid off or fired is incredibly low. At the same time, the job openings rate, which is what basically the headline of the JOLTS series, at 11 million suggests that, you know, again, labor shortage, companies can't get enough workers. So the two seem to be very consistent with the idea that the U.S. economic system, therefore its labor market, are not just healthy, they're on fire. It's things we haven't seen in a generation across the board, which, again, indicates, on the one hand, the economy's doing well, maybe too well, and that this is going to turn out to be the inflationary background behind what many people are expecting is a repeat of the 1970s.
And so you've got a graph here, and it shows this unbelievable spike in job openings. Incredible. And then hires, not as high, but still pretty high. But this is just the absolute number. It's not adjusted for the growth in the population, which you do on our next graph. And both of the lines here, both hires and openings, are relatively high. It's better than a stick in the eye or a punch to the left kidney is what I'm trying to say. Great, great. But you do draw our attention, and it's in the title of the article. This sort of stalled out. You know, am I being greedy, Jeff? I mean, it's stalled out at a super high level, but
that's the point. Yes, we should be seeing more hires. And that's really the point here, is that job openings are through the, I mean, the job openings, you know, before this year, job openings peaked, I think, in 2018 at around not even 7 million or somewhere around 6 point something million. We're talking 11 million job openings, which suggests, as you hear in any mainstream media article, that the economy is just simply on fire. There's such a traumatic labor shortage. We can't get Americans to work, that companies are just, they're putting out all sorts of job opening advertisements all over the internet, trying to get people to work. But at the same time, they're not hiring at nearly the same pace. In fact, hiring is, relatively speaking, lackluster. When you adjust for population, as you were just alluding to, hiring in October, which is the latest data for JOLTS, it's 1 month further behind than the payroll report. But the latest hiring numbers from October weren't really that different from, say, something like the middle 2000s, which wasn't that great of a labor market. So if we got job openings at an epic, historical, biblical high, why isn't the rate of hiring following along at least somewhat closely? But they're actually in almost two different extremes. Job openings are way up there. Well, as you said, hires aren't, it's not a sharp stick in the eye. It's not something awful, but it's not really all that good either. And the question is, what is really going on here? Why do we have two very almost outright conflicting data points here? Companies say they want workers, but yet they're not actually hiring workers.
And you can see that in your initial graph, Jeff. You can see how before 2008, there was a relationship. They were following each other perfectly fine. It wasn't always one-to-one. There was some space between them, fine. And we could see that space again between hires and openings after 2008 until 2011. But we can dismiss it, right? We can say it doesn't have to be perfectly following each other. But then as you circle a 2014 Eurodollar squeeze number 3, 2018, they start to diverge even more than in 2014. In 2018, they diverge even more. That's the fourth Eurodollar squeeze. And now we're in 2021. It's just unrelated. It's there's something broken.
Right. Something is not right here. And it's not just this year. We've seen it happen repeatedly where we get into these reflationary periods. Job openings do one thing. The rate of hires do something else. Everybody follows job openings and says, like the unemployment rate, this must be the real economy. When all the other data says, no, it's actually moribund. It's more like the rate of hires, the lackluster rate of hires. And so consistently, cycle after cycle after cycle now, job openings go up for reasons that have never really been explained. We can speculate, and I think we can make some reasonable guesses about what's really going on here. But we don't actually have the data to say, this is what's really happening in job openings, or this is what's going on in hires. But at least with the hiring parts of JOLTS, we have all sorts of corroborative data, including the turnover rate in JOLTS and how that translates into the headline establishment survey or the current employment statistics or the current employment survey of the major payroll statistics, which suggest, at least, you know, setting aside the difference between job openings and hires right now, what has the economy been doing over the last several months? So even if we take job openings at its face value and say, yes, demand for labor is skyrocketing, at least it's no longer skyrocketing. As you mentioned earlier, the rate of job openings, it wasn't actually a record high in October, even though it was 11 million. It was a record high back in July. And really, the rate of job openings peaked, or at least began to peak, or at least stopped accelerating back in June. So from June, July, August, September, now October, we've seen job openings incredibly high, but not really going any higher. Maybe they had nowhere. I mean, maybe that's the most they could absolutely ever get to. You know, maybe this is sort of the way of job openings telling us that, okay, yeah, we're at an incredible pace for those, but it's not more incredible over the last 6 months. Something maybe has changed here.
A moment ago, you mentioned the turnover rate, and I'd like you to tell the audience what that is and if it has something to do with quits. And Jeff, I have a question for you. You know, previously, before the plague, when people quit their jobs, that sounded positive because you would assume that they've got a better job they're going to. But I'm a little worried that the quits number, which is very, very high right now, might not be conveying just the purely positive, I've got another job, narrative, implicit assumption that we have about it that maybe has something to do with the mandates and the medicine that you have to take and the vaccines. And maybe, you know, again, just like with openings, we don't have the data. We can't ask these people, well, did you quit because you've got a better job or because you don't want to submit to something? What do you think of that?
That's a possibility too. And that gets into the turnover behind the labor market numbers. And I would also add that there's also the possibility that people were, you know, as the economy was the last stages of reopening, the final stages of reopening in the middle of this year, where lockdowns were removed in some certain states in the United States, where workers went back to work with the promise that, hey, you know, employers, we're not really going to pay you much, but we expect the economy is going to pick up because everybody says it's going to pick up. And so as it does, you know, come work for us. We can't really pay you much today, but we'll make sure we make it worth your while down the road. But then we get to a couple months later and things really haven't changed. And all of a sudden workers say, I came back to work for essentially nothing. Maybe it's not worth it. Maybe it's not worth it working either way. But you're right. We don't really know why, but over the last several months, going back to around June, people have been quitting at an epic rate. The level of quits and jolts got up to above 4.3 million, almost 4.4 million, which is far higher than anything we've ever seen. So something is creating this negative turnover in the labor market, combined with the fact that companies aren't actually hiring much, especially going back to June. Again, the rate of hires peaked in June, as did the acceleration of job openings. So since June, hiring activity has come down a bit. Quitting rates have gone up a bit. Layoffs and discharges have been basically the same. So we're seeing weaker headline payroll numbers, where payroll actual net growth, net turnover, net positive turnover has shrunk month after month after month, almost in a consistent straight line basis. So that we get to the November payroll report, which is 1 month further beyond the latest JOLTS. But remember the last payroll report last week, which was enormously disappointing at barely 200,000, which suggests that maybe the labor market, whatever's causing it, the labor market overall has been softening for the last almost 6 months, 5 months now.
That's the key, ladies and gentlemen. June. It's been some time where we've seen economic activity stalling. We've been talking about the capital markets stalling since March. You know, they hit a high, went down, a little bit of a rebound, and now they're going down again. You look back through March, you would say they've stalled since March. The economic accounts, the openings, the hires, the quits, and then you also raise a couple more. Consumer credit, revolving consumer credit, U.S. consumer confidence. June in Germany, May. So we're seeing something happen around that time period, and you offer a few ideas why that might be. You don't mention any virus in here, Jeff, so I'll mention that's a possibility. Maybe it was the virus that did this. You offer some other possibilities why this may have started. And the first one is the helicopter payments that they diffused, they ran out of steam, they did what they did, but they weren't continuous. That's why I always complain about these the politicians. They want to provide a stimulus, great, but that hasn't worked for 14 years. Why don't they try something new and provide a stimulus every single month? That might work. I know we're getting off track, but the point is,
don't give them any ideas, because I think that's what they want to do.
Do they? I really don't think they do. I don't think they're taking it seriously. If they wanted to do it, they would do it. I was looking at Franklin Roosevelt's first 100 days in office, and he had, I think he passed 70 new laws. He had 90 executive orders. And you look at everyone else since then, and it doesn't compare. It doesn't compare.
No,
it
seemed
like that was like, you know, I'm going for it. Something's desperately wrong, and maybe I didn't do it right, but I'm doing something.
Yes, that's it. The fact that during Roosevelt's first 100 days, everybody knew that we're stuck in the worst depression in American history. So there was no inhibition, nor should there have been. But in, you know, nowadays, it's okay. Yeah, we knew the coronavirus recession was going to be bad, but it seems like we got out of it. And not only that, you hear all of these economists and central bankers and everybody around the world, the financial media, saying, oh my God, we've overdone it. We've done too much. So we can't do any more. Look at the inflation. The mainstream narrative has wrongly identified inflation as the primary cause behind consumer prices rising. As we know, that's not really what's going on. It's mostly about supply and demand imbalances. But as far as politicians are concerned, they're going to listen to economists. They're going to listen to people in the financial media. We're telling them, oh my God, you've done too much here. The economy's too good. You can't do any more. But the real fact of the matter is, just breaking it down into specific cases, what you just said, the stipends, the transfer payments, they were all front loaded to the beginning of the year. So you had heavy government influence, fiscal influence, you know, late December, January, that was the second helicopter. And then again, March and April, that was the third and the biggest one. But ever since then, you've had, you know, stipends in the form of unemployment benefits, pandemic relief and things like that. But those have been petering out, too. So the level of involvement of Uncle Sam in the economy sort of peaked around April. And ever since April, it's been less and less and less. So, yes, there's going to be some lingering effects of some people who didn't immediately spend their stimulus stipends and have been waiting to do so. But by and large, starting from that perspective, what we would expect is that, yeah, there would be a frenzy of activity closely associated in time and calendar with the fiscal interventions, and then it would have less and less of an impact over time, to the point where it might actually have a negative impact if people went too far during that initial frenzied period. Contrary to econometric models, which think that there's a positive multiplier here, and if the government spends, that leads to other spending and other spending and other spending in a continuous virtuous circle, that never happens. And so, and realistically, we'd expect that there would be a slowdown at the very least from the frenetic pace that had been set by Uncle Sam earlier in the year. So The fact that there's a slowdown in the second half of the year really shouldn't be surprising, but yet it is because, you know, the mainstream narrative is set by econometric models.
Another issue that you raised that possibly set things off on the wrong foot in June was oil, gasoline, energy prices. And you remind us that
quote unquote inflation itself, right?
Don't be careful what you wish for. Inflation creating central bankers. You got the inflation, but it was in energy prices. Yeah.
Yeah, this is something that you and I talked about with Bilal Hafiz a couple of weeks back, where he said, you know, he pointed out, historically speaking, you get an oil price shock, you expect a recession with not too much longer thereafter, because those two things correlate. You know, when oil prices go up, as long as it's not because of inflation, we don't expect that to go up, to continue to go up. We don't expect that the economy is going to easily absorb the oil price shock, because there isn't the money flowing behind it that will allow it to continue to go up. And essentially what you're doing is the energy sector robs a lot of vitality and activity from other parts of the economy, that then these other parts of the economy, which suffer the consequence of essentially the fact that we need energy for everything. And if we have to pay for energy, we can't pay for other things. Then overall, given enough time, you would expect the economy to start to slow down to the point where it becomes into, you know, a realistic recessionary danger. In fact, historically speaking, that's the two actually go together pretty well. They have an oil price shock and a recession not long thereafter. So, you know, oil prices and gasoline prices, they aren't really that much higher than they were 3 years ago, but the rate of change has been incredibly big. So the acceleration has been sufficient enough that we would expect some sort of deflationary growth slowdown backlash just from gasoline and energy prices alone. And then, of course, speaking outside the United States, Europe in particular, where the prices of things like natural gas have just exploded upward, it becomes an even bigger deflationary slowdown issue, because now energy prices and, you know, things like heating, basic living necessities, have gone through the roof even further than gasoline. So slowdown from an oil price shock, those two things usually do go together.
So to summarize, there are some good measures in the United States employment situation, but there are more measures that suggest some sort of stalling since the summer. Jeff, help me segue to some other topic. That's the end of this episode. Is there anything? Save me.
Yeah, so I think the segue, or at least the takeaway, should be that, you know, what we were expected at the beginning of the year, including in the bond market and fixed income and global credit markets, was reflation continuing. Good times. The end of the pandemic was in sight. Tremendous fiscal stimulus that was going to create a real recovery virtuous circle. And then we get to February and March, and then the global bond market started to say no. And as we pointed out as you pointed out very well in the last segment, it's not that interest rates have fallen all that much since March. It's the fact that they haven't continued to rise, that yield curves and other curves haven't continued to steepen. For now going on 9 months, the curves have been at least sideways to somewhat flatter, which belies the fact that, you know, hey, this was supposed to be a very good year from beginning to end. And in fact, when we look back at this year, it really had, you know, maybe January, February, but that was it. Ever since then, we get into March forward, it's been growing concerns, growing problems, not economic growth, and certainly not inflationary growth. There's been, you know, as we said before, escalating series of warnings in these credit markets that we're seeing being borne out by the economic data, not just in the U.S. labor market, nor just the U.S. economy, but all over the world, where especially since around mid-year, at the very least, the economy has slowed way down, and maybe potentially more than that, as we see, you know, yield curves and Eurodollar futures curves and other things are warning that next year begins under this cloud of suspicion, which means we don't know is necessarily what it actually means, but it probably doesn't mean picking back up where we left off in March and April.
How is the global economy doing? That depends on your perspective. So writes Gillian Tett of the Financial Times. And we just had a perfect example of the economic situation in the U.S. labor market. Great news over here, but also bad news over here. How do we reconcile the two? Well, I'm going to read this column out to Jeff, get his perspective, get his live reaction, and then maybe we'll settle on some methodology, some way to settle conflicting signals in part 3 of this episode.